this is my take. You know, politics is a very integral part of the society, and it has this power to give solutions to the society of entrenched inequalities, social economic inequalities in particular. So if I come back to your question about Raila, if what we saw today in his launch of the presidency is about him becoming the fifth president of the Republic of Kenya, then I don't foresee any change. It's just going to be one of those rituals, if I may call it so, like part of just a democratic society that must have periodic elections. But if it is about addressing the social inequalities that have been entrenched by previous governments, then I see I can be hopeful that this is a moment for him. So if it is about him just clinching power, because he has tried, you know, this is the fifth time.
Yeah.
If it's just about him clinching that seat, then this is just any other cycle of elections, and it won't benefit the Kenyans. I don't want to look at Raila as a person or with his ambitions of becoming a president. I want to look at what is he bringing on the table for Kenyans, because at the end of the day, it's not about him, it's about the Kenyans. He's supposed to clinch this seat so as to serve Kenyans. So if it's not about addressing the social and economic inequalities that are already there, then this is just any other cycle that we have seen in the past.
Well,
then there is the issue, secondly, I might note this. This is very important because, you know, Raila's cycle, as in the president's four times now, we always know how it will end. Even those people who are not politically knowledgeable will tell you Raila goes into politics, elections are held, and then there are allegations of stealing elections, and then he loses, and he ends up being an opposition leader. So he has come to be known as this veteran opposition leader. And some people and some commentators have actually said he does a very good job when he's in the opposition. He has unearthed some of those evils in the previous government, and he would tell us about the corruption cases that were ongoing that Kenyans were not aware about. So people came to associate him with the opposition. So, yeah, we are looking forward to see what about when he clinches power, how will he embrace this new phase of being now at the steering wheel?
Let's talk a little bit about the variables, because now we're seeing a president not endorsing his vice president and a president literally supporting an opposition figure in Raila Odinga. How much of an influence might Uhuru Kenyatta have in the fortunes of Raila Odinga?
Yeah, that is very interesting. And it doesn't come as a surprise, because this has developed up to this day. You know, immediately Raila had this handshake with Uhuru. There was this was a build-up. People could already see probably Uhuru at some point will endorse Raila. And the politics of endorsement is very common in Kenya. And I think for a long time, Raila has always wanted someone from the mountain. Okay, they call them people from central. That is where Uhuru Kenyatta hails from. And that's where Kibaki hailed from. And after Kibaki's era, if I go back a bit, it was expected that after supporting Kibaki, endorsing Kibaki, that is Raila endorsing Kibaki, there was the expectation that the Kibaki will reciprocate, but he went silent on that. So I see there is a bit of excitement that perhaps by endorsing him, that means, you know what that means in the Kenyan context? That the tribe that Uhuru Kenyatta belongs to then will automatically vote for Raila. But as we know, that wouldn't be the case, because these are two big tribes. You know, Raila comes from a big tribe. Uhuru Kenyatta comes from a big tribe. If you look at historically, there has been the tendency of every tribe, and especially the big ones, fronting their own person, which is not the right thing to do. So it's not going to automatically translate. It is too early to say that the Mount Kenya region will not want to have their own person and support it. So it's not going to be that very automatic that he would definitely get the votes from the central part of Kenya. But if it does, good for him. So, yeah, we have to understand at this point, he has just presented himself for presidency. as an ODM, of course, leader and that. But there's still other people in ODM, I want to believe, like Wanjigi has also shown interest, people from Western, a few candidates. So I don't know if there will be elections to finally settle on who, but we know how it will go. Most probably Raila, with his commanding of force we saw today, he's likely to take that mantle and take the bid for presidents ahead. So yes, it's a good thing, and it's a step in the right place. But I know it comes from a place where the president fell out with his deputy, and we could see it like in broad daylight, like they were antagonistic, you know. The deputy president would openly talk against the president, and I think him going ahead and endorsing the opposition letter then does not come as a surprise.
So I've been listening to you talk, and it seems that there's quite a number of influences. One is the desire for a better life and that people want to vote on issues. But then there's this other influence, which sounds still quite strong in Kenyan politics, and that's the tribal factor. Which one is more influential? If a voter goes to the polls, when does he vote for the tribe and when does he vote for this guy has promised a better Kenya, I like the manifesto, and discards the tribe?
Okay, yeah. Historically, if we go up to the last election, tribe really played a major role. At the end of the day, I don't know what happens. Even the professionals, at the end of the day, they just go back to their tribal cocoons, and you'll find people say, people from our place. And so because of that, we find that like the first president was from Central. Yes, Jomo Kenyatta was someone from Central. Moi was from Rift Valley, where now Ruto comes from. And then Kibaki was from Central. And then Uhuru is from Central. You see that history. So people are likely to say, we want someone from a different part of Kenya. And because of that, they will be motivated to go into at the ballot box to make that change. But again, Ruto has cleverly coined another political identity. He's trying to come up with something different. This, the first three presidents of Kenya, you know, they have come from this, what now people have come to know, known as dynasties. Like they come from these political families, elites, like Uhuru is the son of the first president. And Raila is also a son of the former premier. So now Ruto comes just from an ordinary family, and he has come up with another narrative of hustler. Now people, the hustler to mean a common mwananchi versus the dynasties. Because he has not gotten that endorsement of the current president. Now he has come up with his other narrative to say that Kenyans, look here. Let's not just give these people the recycled leaders from the dynasties, from these big families in Kenya. We cannot just be going around three or four families in Kenya. We should also look at, if you do that, then the hustlers' concerns are not taken care of. And people can see that the entrenched social inequalities are there, that the certain rich people who continuously become rich, while the common citizen remains poor. And so he's capitalizing on that. Yes, this narrative is a good narrative. From a political point of view, I would say this is something that is timely. But again, what is Ruto trying to achieve? He's also capitalizing on this narrative to attain what dynasties have also been capitalizing on their own dynasties to achieve power. But again, it's not a narrative that should be wished away. In fact, it should be refashioned. And it should be something that even Raila or other presidential candidates should look at it keenly and say, yes, we acknowledge the inequalities that have been entrenched over time. So what do we do about it? It is not something they should wish away, because Ruto equally is commanding a following in Kenya. And given the COVID situation that has been there and the government locking down businesses and all that, people are now buying into that narrative that it is now. Plus, he's trying to move away from ethnic identity to class, interclass, hustler versus dynasty. So It is something, it's going to play out in the next 1 year. Let's see how it plays out. It will be a very interesting struggle for power.
And a year is a long time in politics. We're going to have to leave it there. Dr. Manyaya, always a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you. Your insights greatly appreciated always. Thank you.
Okay, thank you and good evening.
All right, so there you have it. The Kenyan opposition leader, Raila Odinga, has announced his candidacy as president and started his campaign. A year from now, will he be president? Fifth attempt. Stay with us. You're on The Globe. And after the break, we find out what South Africa has been downgraded for when it comes to freedoms and space, especially given that we're celebrating 25 years of our constitution. Who's done the downgrading and why? Find out after this.